Master. That's better. When I stop in my morning routines and writings and postings and you name it, I love it to get together, really, to record, because I also sit out here and I look around and I begin to feel enveloped with not just God's presence, but God's blessing. You know, how God really has given me a little place, you know, a little sanctuary, a little meeting place, a touchstone, a Ebenezer stone, to meet with Him and to talk with Him and share with you and to care for us in the way that we examine the Word and read devotionals and let them, or actually let God speak to us about the things that He has in store for us today and what He would do with us or have for us to do as we go on our way. And for me, you know, without God, I couldn't do anything. But with Him, boy, I'll tell you. In daily life, let your speech be always with grace. A word fitly spoken is like apples of gold and pitchers of silver. As an earring of gold and an ornament of fine gold, so is a wise reprover upon an obedient ear. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. By thy words thou shalt be justified. The tongue of the wise is health. They that feared the Lord spoke often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before Him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon His name. If thou take forth precious from the vial, thou shalt be as my mouth. Therefore, as you abound in everything, in faith and in utterance and knowledge and in all diligence, seek that you abound in this grace also. It is a challenge in either counseling or sharing or really just talking one person to another to arrange our conversation so that we would have a word aptly spoken, because it's too easy to just blast away with a shotgun effect and blow people out of the water, you know, and that seems to be fun for a lot of people, but there have been times where I know I have written things or said things that have remained with people for a lifetime, and that amazes me, because it's not really me speaking, but it's God in me that chose the right words to say that were coordinated by His timing and His perfect way in bringing together the circumstance and the word that fit. And when He does, it's just like it says, apples of gold and pitchers of silver, and it will last a lifetime if you choose to ask God to speak through you and to allow Him to receive the glory for it, but then also allow Him to maybe curb your tongue when you want to slash and dash and crash somebody's party, you know, and maybe choose a better way, maybe choose a living way, something that God would say instead of what you might say. Thy loving kindness is before mine eyes. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and of great mercy. Your Father, which is in heaven, maketh His sun to shine, to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. Be ye followers of God as your children, and walk in love, as Christ also has loved us, and has given Himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Be ye kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. Seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. The love of Christ constrains us. Love ye your enemies, and do good, and lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great, and ye shall be children of the Highest, for he is kind unto the unthankful and to the evil. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father also is merciful. So many times I read the words that Jesus said of loving your enemies and doing good and kindness and all these things, and then, sadly, I hear among the brethren the idea that we have to stand up for our rights, we have to fight for righteousness' sake, we have to do this, do that, and be this and be that. And yet, it's not scriptural. You know, if you're out there waging war with politics and social justices, you know, and creating hardship and headaches for yourself as well as other people around you, then are you really accomplishing anything for God? I mean, it makes you feel good. It might make society feel good for maybe a year or two. But what is it going to reap in eternity? What is it going to mean when this all passes away? Will it have benefited you anything at all except to say, I did it? I think God would rather have us love our enemies and choose to pray for those that despitefully use us, as well as those whom we can, by our demonstration of that love that God has in us, prove the truth of what Jesus did on the cross by our own lives, possibly sacrificing ourselves in the same way. Because asserting yourself doesn't allow God to assert himself for you. It puts you in control. But when you back away from your position of authority and let God exercise his, then he can move heaven and earth, as well as the powers that be on this earth, to act on your behalf without you doing anything except letting him know. So, while I understand why people do what they do when they get into these socialized groups or these political groups or these activist groups, if you could learn anything from the 60s and from us hippies, you know, is that really activism doesn't accomplish a whole lot. It just keeps going in cycles. And it goes around and around and around, just like the hamster in the cage. It's going to go through a full cycle, whether you participate in it or not. So, what you can do is, with God, present salvation to those so that in eternity they would know Jesus and not be lost in a world that's just spinning its way to hell. That's what I've learned. Maybe God is telling you that.